Good evening. It is Monday, the 12th of August. It is 9 p.m. and we are live for the first of a new season's Cat's Whiskers podcast. Yes, good evening. My name is Antoine Marie-Jeanne, and this is the start of the new season with the first friendly game for the Panthers, just 6 days away. I am joined tonight to look over the latest Panthers signings and previewing upcoming matches, etc., by the main man himself, Mr. Jono Bullard.
Good evening.
And then going over to the brothers, we have Sam Balm.
Hello.
And Joe Balm.
Hello, everyone.
Thanks for joining us, and thanks, guys, for making the time to be available tonight. First of all, before we go any further, it'd be amiss of us to not mention Les Strongman, who sadly passed away a couple of days ago. Jono, you're the oldest out of the lot of us, the longest time Panthers fan. Do you want to say anything in particular?
Yeah, it's very, very sad when anybody who is a legend at the Panthers sadly passes away. But of course, what Les Strongman did, which is a lot different from a lot of other players who played for us, is he actually bridged the original era from 1946 to 1960 and then the modern era when Panthers came back to the Ice Stadium in 1980. He was the head coach when we came back. He was heavily involved with junior development throughout that time. And it's a very, very sad loss for the Nottingham Panthers. He will always be known as a Panthers legend, like Chick Zamek before him. But 95, it's a great innings, and we've lost a great man associated with the Nottingham Panthers.
We have indeed, and fingers crossed there'll be an equally great tribute paid to him at the start of the new season. So moving on then from there, obviously our thoughts from the entire Cat's Whiskers crew are with Liz's family and his friends. So moving on from there, we can talk about the last few signings. And there's been quite a few since the last podcast of the off-season. We'll go all the way back to Sam Herr, 26-year-old forward, American forward, joined from the Ontario Reign in the AHL. 4 seasons in the AHL, icing just shy of 200 games. Not a prolific point scorer, Joe, but was alternate captain. So leadership seems to be a key thing in the press release for him.
Yeah, I mean, they don't just give around like A's and C's in the AHL to anybody. So during his time with Ontario, he obviously showed something that sort of showed to the club that he was deserving of that alternate captaincy. But I think we've got a bit of an underrated player here. I mean, from looking at his stats, he obviously wasn't the biggest point scorer, but he's been sort of played in as a defensive forward during his time, and I think he'll be certainly allowed to stretch his legs with the Panthers and sort of really start to show what he can do offensively. And then hopefully he brings quite a lot of that to the table. And with his sort of leadership, with his having a younger team, that can only help. And I think he'll be a good addition to our roster.
Yeah, I agree with you there completely. Sam, any thoughts?
Yes, he might not have the sort of the prolific scoring, but I see him as a top six forward on this roster, and I think he'll probably still be a key penalty killer for us, but I think he will get a lot more time not only on the ice but in offensive situations. So I think he's a player that we could be looking forward to have sort of a breakout season.
Jono, 26 years old, as we said, straight out of the AHL. You know, in any other day and age, that'd be a marquee signing, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would. And it is a marquee signing. You can't knock the fact that he's played 193 times in the past four seasons in the AHL, the league below the NHL in North America. That's a big signing. And no, he's not a prolific goal scorer, but you don't... One thing, these things that we don't know, and it's something I've said a lot on my Periscopes, is the teams make a signing and everybody goes to Elite Prospects and looks them up because it's the only real information we've got. And yes, there'll be a few YouTube clips or whatever, but it's very, very difficult to form an opinion on the player unless you've actually seen them play. And from what I picked up about Sam Herr, I think he was more of a defensive forward. And from the interviews when he was announced as signing, from I think both Guy Doucette and Tim Wallace were both saying that they want him to have a more offensive role with the Panthers. So it looks like he's coming in here not to be the defensive forward that he has been, but to actually play probably a more prolific role around the net. So it'd be interesting to see how he does. But it's like we said, you play 193 times in the AHL and you were an alternate captain as well, we've certainly got no slouch there.
Agreed. And then moving on swiftly, George Golikoff's joined us from the MK Lightning, so very well known to our coach Tim Wallace. Joe, back to you again. 24 years old, he scored 40 points last season. Pretty much, you know, from it was an awful time for MK last season. Let's not, you know, beat around the bush for that. But he was certainly a shining light in that team, wasn't he?
Yeah, I think with the sort of the things going on in MK last year, I think Golikoff was one of the sort of brighter lights coming out of their season, getting to watch him play. I mean, from what I remember him and from what I've seen from clips, He's a very quick, dynamic player. He likes to get at opponents' D-man with his quick stick handling, try and get around them and sort of get them confused. And, I mean, putting up 40 points for what was the worst team in the league last year, I think that's a good output. And hopefully, with a better line mates this year, he couldn't equal that or even add to it. So I think definite good addition and fits in with the kind of roster we're building here, or we've built.
Sam, your brother's picked up on what I was going to ask you. Certainly the thing that Guy Doucette has been saying repeatedly in his interviews is the team that they're looking to build, they want to build a fast-paced attacking team. Do you see Golikoff fitting that sort of dynamic? Sam, have we lost him? Jono?
Hello?
Sam, are you there?
Yeah, hello?
Yeah, did you hear what I just said?
Yeah, sorry, yeah.
wake up, man, you're not at school anymore.
Yes, as I was saying, yeah, you know, I think if he wants to build a fast-paced team, you've got to go younger. And I think, you know, with him being 24, he's got room to definitely grow and improve. And, you know, he's, you know, 40 points. He was, you know, fourth highest scorer on MK last season. We've got two of the four, you know, two of their top four scorers in Wallace and Golikoff. So I think that's it's quite positive.
And Jono, any thoughts on Golikoff that the brothers haven't picked up on already?
Not much more to add. It's just, I think it'd be interesting to see what he does with a team like the Panthers. I mean, obviously it's going to be a lot different from playing at MK. There was obviously a lot of problems there last season. Lots of stories came out after the end of the season. So it'll be interesting to see how he does when, I suppose, his mind can focus completely on the hockey. Also, a deeper squad he's in. So I know a lot of people have been saying, well, he scored 40 points, he should be getting at least that in Nottingham. But don't forget, he's going from a three-line team to what will likely be a four-line team. So he may not have as much ice time as what he had in Milton Keynes. So we'll see. But I think I'm quite excited to see how he does in Nottingham. Like it was said, he was one of MK's better or best players last year. So let's see what he can do at the NIC.
I'm going to skip a little bit, Jono, because you've mentioned something there that I actually wanted to bring in when we talked about Brett Bulmer. So just skipping the next few players, we'll come back to them. But Brett Bulmer joined us from the Five Flyers, where he was their top point scorer last season. Jono, you mentioned there that, you know, he's likely going to be getting a bit less ice time than he got at MK. We had this last season when Doty joined us, didn't we? When Doty was signed, he put up a hell of a lot of points when playing for the Clan, but played a very different role when he came to us. Do you think that, you know, Bulmer, as great a season as he had last year, can you see him sort of replicating that with the Panthers, or do you see a reduced role affecting his performance like we saw with Doty?
No, I think Bulmer will be one of our
completely
go-to
different
guys.
Players, obviously.
Yeah,
you know,
they are totally different players. It's a little unfair to compare him with Jacob Doty, because Doty was a completely different player. Brett Bulmer was Fife's top scorer. Brett Bulmer's had spells in the NHL. I think 20 games he had with Minnesota Wild. He's played in the AHL. He's played in the DEL. He's played in the Liga in Finland. So I think he's going to be one of our go-to guys. And one of the things that we'll probably get onto when we're summarising everything is I don't think there's a lot of goals in this Panthers squad, or this certainly doesn't look to be on paper. He scored 26 goals last season, so I think he's going to be one of the people who has been employed to put the puck in the net. So I don't think his role is going to be that different from what it was in Fife. I think he is going to be one of the go-to offensive guys.
Joe, back to you. Your thoughts on Bulmer? I must admit, he's the one that sort of stuck out for me out of all the signings that we've made recently. Certainly enjoyed watching him in the few times we saw him against Fife last year.
Yeah, I mean, from what I remember him, good player, physical, liked to fight. I mean, we saw him fight Steve Lee last year, and he sort of finished Steve Lee's season early, I think he broke his jaw. But yeah, I think he's definitely a player that brings, he's got different elements to his game. We've seen that he has sort of the point scoring ability, but he's also got that agitator sort of style to his game as well, that we've sort of maybe lost now that Farmer's gone to DEL too. So I think overall he's a good signing. That's not just, it's not just points. There is different positives to the signing.
Certainly, maybe looking for him to play the power forward role there. There was a few mutterings in the social media side when, based on the press release, that, you know, the class team is an NHL forward. Any player that's played, regardless of how long they've played in NHL, they deserve some recognition, surely. I mean, yes, he may have only had a cup of tea, but, you know, he's played at the highest levels, hasn't he?
Yeah, and, you know, you don't just get a free pass to play in the NHL. You have to earn it. So I think, yeah, that's a positive, you know. And I think Bulmer adds two things that, up to this point, thought we were lacking, and that's like I said, it is, it's grit and it's goals. You know, I think we you know, on the roster as a whole, we probably still are lacking goals, but you know, I've thought that for the past few seasons. But you know, I think he could definitely be one of the difference makers in this team.
Absolutely do. If you'd like to get in touch with us while we're on air, the easiest way is via our Twitter handle at CatsWhiskersTV. Mr. Bullard is monitoring that as we speak, so we'll try and pull in any comments that as they come in. But obviously, if you're listening to this while we're not live, still feel free to tweet us, because I'm sure it can create discussion points for future shows. So we'll rewind then, back after the Golikov signing. Dylan Malmquist was announced straight out the NCAA, 150 games in the NCAA for a total of 91 points. Played in the Frozen Four twice, and, you know, was a star at Notre Dame. Jono, I'm going to start with you again on this one. You're very high on Dylan, aren't you?
Yeah, I really, really looking forward to seeing what this guy can bring to the team. Like you say, I was very excited when his signing was announced, because of where he's come from. He's come from one of the top universities in the NCAA, certainly hockey-wise. Like you say, that team has reached the Frozen Four twice in the past 4 years. Have always made the playoffs in the past 4 years while Malmquist has been icing for them. And the standard at the NCAA is phenomenal. And I think there was a lot of unfair comments when he signed, with a lot of people saying, you know, oh, well, what are we doing signing a player straight out of college? He's never played pro. Yeah. NCAA teams are pro in everything but name. The way they're set up, the way they are managed, the people, the entourage they have. I've seen it all at the Friendship Four in Belfast, that they are so wonderfully run. They have like nutrition coaches, they have video coaches, they have fitness coaches. It's a completely different world. Yeah, you know, those players are almost trained to be NHL players, and a lot of players from that level are drafted to the NHL. But Malmquist himself, I think, went to Minnesota Wild training camp. I could be wrong with the team, but he certainly went to an NHL training camp prior to him signing with the Panthers. But I think that they decided that his game probably was more suited to the European style, and here he is. I am really, really looking forward to seeing what he can bring, because if he was one of the top guys, and it looks like he was one of the top guys at Notre Dame last year, then he is probably going to be one of the top guys in this Panthers roster. So, yeah, I am very, very excited about this signing.
Yeah, it's certainly, I mean, he was an alternate last season, Sam. So, you know, when you're looking at, you know, top guys, can you see him, you know, providing a bit of a spark maybe for a Panthers revival this season?
Yeah, you know, I think he's definitely got a lot of potential. You know, I think from, you know, Doucette's interview about him, you know, he's quite excited to have signed him, and, you know, really happy. You know, I think if he does play to his full potential, then, you know, there may be other European teams that come looking for him mid-season. So, you know, we could potentially be lucky to hold on to him.
I mean, Joe, we don't like to talk about players leaving, you know, mid-season, but certainly if he is using as, you know, as a stepping stone, that's fair play, isn't it? But you'd hope that if he does perform well, he stays with us for the season.
Yeah, I mean, Wallace mentioned in an interview that they hope to get him, keep him for a year, maybe even two. But, I mean, yeah, it's not great if we lose players, but I suppose if you do lose players like Malmquist, who are using us as a springboard to a better league, then that shows that he's performing well for us. And at the very least, we've had a good output from a player, albeit however long he stays. But if he was to move on, we've at least had somebody performing well for us, who could, you know, sort of put us in good stead until the point he leaves. But, yeah, if he was to move on, it obviously means he's done well. And it would be sad to go see him go, but obviously he's 22. He's still got a full career ahead of him. So, as a fan base, we'd have to wish him well.
Yeah, I mean, he certainly, you know, everybody casts envious glances over to the likes of Cardiff. They've managed to retain a core of their imports. I'll just throw this question open to the three of you. You know, the we've got a couple of young kids there, relatively speaking, in her, Golikovs, Malmquist. You know, Bulmer's only 27 as well. Would it be nice to, you know, to start building an import quota that, you know, stays 3, 4, 5 seasons?
Can I come in with that one?
Go for it, Johnny.
Because, yeah, this is something that is very, very important to me. And one of the reasons I renewed my season ticket is because we had a change in direction with Guillaume Doucette and then Tim Wallace coming in as coach. And you look at... bringing in Cardiff is absolutely right, and envious glances is exactly the right phrase, because they have held on to a core of their players, and that, I believe, is one of the main reasons why they've been so successful. We've retained two imports from last season. Now, last season was terrible, but we all know that, so you probably wouldn't want to retain any more than a couple of inputs. But the point I'm making is, if we can start to look at building a core that can take us forward for the next few seasons, then it can only work in our favour, I think. You see how successful it's been at Cardiff. Why can't that be successful in Nottingham? And I think that is what Guillaume Doucette has been brought in to try and do, to be perfectly honest. Getting younger players who have a great team ethic, all through these signings, all that's been mentioned is work ethic, team ethic, playing in a team. So yeah, it's not building great individual players, it's building a team. It may take time, it may take 2 or 3 seasons, but I think that's what we need to start, and I think this roster could be the foundations of that.
Yeah, we'll just go away from we'll pause on the player thoughts for a bit, because you've picked up a key thing there, again, Jono. I think with the team ethic that, you know, Tim and Guy are starting to build. So, Joe, Sam, I just want to get your thoughts. It does look very much like we are actually trying to put round pegs in round holes for once.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's been a long time coming, because I think over the last couple of seasons we've not really had a team that's sort of that almost represents the fan base, almost, because I think most of the fan base would be extremely happy to see a team go out there every night and work hard, even if the result doesn't necessarily go our way. To see the players work hard, I think, would be greatly appreciated. And I think, I mean, as Jono mentioned earlier, and so did Sam, that we're potentially a little bit light on goals. I think this year we've got the kind of players in that could see sort of an increase in goals. Whereas last year, the last couple of seasons, we brought in older players and then they were just surrounded in with individuals, not hard-working players. So where these older players, maybe they're a bit slower, maybe a bit like a Ling, but Ling had people around him that could do all the work, and then Ling could sort of pull the strings. Whereas I think the last couple of seasons, we've had like a team of individuals. So the chemistry's not been there. You haven't had players working hard for their line mates, which meant in terms of production, you're either getting similar to what they've always done or less. Whereas I think this season we've got players that hopefully and look like they'll be really working for each other. So I think if that is how it turns out, I think we could be getting a lot more production than sort of the stats of our players suggest from previous seasons. So sort of that angle, I'm certainly looking forward to this hard-working team we've put together.
Sam, any final thoughts on that?
I definitely say I think with Doucette and Wallace, they understand the league, and you can see that the team has been built with that in mind. I think perhaps with Churnham, as he didn't fully understand it, and you know, he went for a big heavy team, and that's, you know, the league has moved away from that. And I think definitely, like Joe says, there's there's like a clear, you know, there's a plan and the way I think we're going to play. And like you said with Ling, I think that's maybe sort of how Jakobs will play, you know, sort of the older player, playmaker with some like younger players with him. I think he could get quite a few assists this season.
Okay. We'll skip the next signing because, you know, I actually wanted to, you know, talk about that person in a little bit more detail because it did cause a bit of chat in the social media wings. But so we were then treated to a smorgasbord, as you like. Two Swedes came in on the same day. William Quist, a 30-year-old forward, joins us straight from the Herlev Eagles in Denmark. He was the third highest point scorer last season and also has played 232 Allsvenskan, yeah, Swedish league games.
All Svenskan. There we go.
Thank you, John. I need to put my teeth back in. And then Jens Jacobs, 34-year-old winger, joins us from Altoona in that same league, which Jono just pronounced for us.
Oh, 530,
thank you. 513 times for a lot of points. Also played 119 games in the SHL. Jono, since you helped me out with the pronunciation there.
You managed SHL, which was good to see.
Yeah, well, there we go. go. Yeah, your thoughts on Quiston Jacobs, and do you think it was planned to release them both on the same day in the same press release?
Oh, yeah. Was that the one where they had the Swedish female footballer who played for Bayern Munich? Or absolutely. If they wanted to release the names on the same day, I'm sure they were probably signed a while prior to that, more than likely. But two very decent signings. Quist, like you said, third highest point scorer in the Danish league last season. He was the top scorer for Herlev Eagles. 232 Allsvenskan games as well. This guy will know how to play. 30 years old, so plenty of experience, and I think, like Bulmer, I think he's going to be one of our go-to guys regarding scoring the goals. Jacobs, very experienced, 119 SHL games. You're no mug if you play at that level. A huge number of games in the Allsvenskan. For I think 316 points he scored in his 513 games. I can see him probably being third, second line, maybe used on the power play, and you know, for me, they're two very, very good signings because we all know Swedish players can play a bit.
Exactly. Jove, your views first on Quist.
Yeah, I think Quist is a good player. I mean, we've clearly seen from last season that he's certainly got the potential to put up a lot of points. I mean, from, I think it was the interview with Doucette, it sounded like he was sort of allowed to sort of stretch his legs, as it were, in terms of his offensive capabilities last season, really allowed to sort of give him the freedom to really show what he can do offensively. And it shows, I mean, being the third top scorer in his league. So, yeah, and I think, like Jono said, like Bulmer, I think Quist will be one of our sort of specific go-to guys when we may be struggling to, you know, if some stuff's not quite clicking in a game, I think he could be one of our players that can sort of have that little something that could sort of get us going in the game.
And Sam, Jacobs, 34 years old, so approaching, you know, the twilight of his career. Can you see him playing a similar role to that of a certain Mr. Ling, who's already been mentioned in tonight's podcast?
Yeah, definitely. I think, you know, as I said before, I think
if he's on a line with younger players that can do a lot of the skating for him. You know, I think that's definitely a very good thing. I would expect that Jaekers will probably see quite a bit of time quarterback in the power play as well. You know, I think he definitely looks quite a good sign. I mean, you know, his point scoring has sort of trailed off in the past few seasons, but I definitely think coming into this league with the right players with him, that he could definitely be quite a good point scorer for us.
I mean, I'll throw the next question open to the three of you again. Widely seen, is it a little bit mean almost to paint all Swedish skaters in the same light? I mean, we've had some greats. I mean, straight away, Johan Molin comes to mind. Got to love those white skates. But there was a lot of excitement on, you know, the Cage Forum in particular about, you know, we signed a couple of Swedish players and, you know, you expect them to be fast skaters and good skaters and what have you. Is that doing them a little bit disservice, do you think, Jono? Because, I mean, Quist in particular looks like he's not a small player.
No, but that is the way they are trained in Sweden. Swedish players are generally, from a very young age, taught how to skate. A lot of work is done on their skating. It's part of their training. I can't remember who it was. There was a player, may have been David Longstaff, who went to Sweden in the early 2000s from the Sheffield Steelers, and it was something that he said in an interview, that, you know, they really do work in training on their skating to getting to be better skaters. And I think Robert Dowd said something similar when he went to the Allsvenskan. So it is part of their game, because it is trained and drilled into them in from an early age, and I think that's why we do generally think of the Swedes being very, very good skaters as a whole. And it's a generalisation, certainly, but I think it's a fair generalisation.
I mean, Joe and Sam, can you see Quist and Jaekers playing on the same line, maybe?
Maybe not. I think Quist probably most likely be first line. And I think Jakobs could be second or third. But then again, if in training camp they strike up a bit of chemistry and Wallace likes what he sees, I think, yeah, there is the potential that he then plays first line. But I think I'd sort of say most likely second line.
Sam, any further thoughts?
I think it's quite difficult to really sort of predict the lines, because I don't think there's sort of a clear first line, second line, third line in this squad. I think it's very much sort of
balanced.
It's balanced, yeah. You haven't essentially got a really good first line and then the quality drops off as you go down. I think it is quite a balanced roster, and I think that's something that could really benefit us if with the player lineups is right and there's a balance going through the teams, you could have, you know, three, four lines doing well for you rather than just one or two.
That's good. The final signing then was announced at the shirt unveiling on Friday lunchtime. Was it Friday or was it Thursday?
Friday,
yeah. Friday lunchtime, where the Panthers did a shirt unveiling at the City Centre branch of the Nottingham, who, of course, the main team sponsors of the Nottingham Panthers. Jason DeSantis, 33-year-old D-man, American D-man, joins us straight from the E-Bell. He's, you know, classed as an offensive defenseman, has AHL and Czech experience. Sam, I'll stay with you. Were you expecting them to announce another signing? Bear in mind, by that point, I think we've completed our import quota.
Yes, I was. Mainly because Doucette, when we sort of had got, like,
okay, we think the defence is complete. Du said he was still looking for defencemen. And I think as well, it's been sort of rumoured in the past few days before that there would be an announcement at the unveiling. It's a signing that I'm very pleased with. He's right-handed, which I think really complements our defence, because there was a bit of a sort of a balance towards the left there. And I think signing DeSantis gives us the option mainly for maybe Matheson not to play as much, so he can be behind the bench more. And I just think his offensive ability, I think our defence is definitely improved from last season. Not only in terms of quality, but also in terms of mobility. Our defence looks a lot more mobile this season. That's really going to help us with, playing out from the back, transition. And I think that's something that's, with a quick team, you really need.
Joe, your thoughts on DeSantis?
Yeah, I think, like Sam said, I think it's pretty obvious that he's sort of got that offensive side of his game. I'm not 100% sure whether he's a very much offensive defenseman or a bit more of a two-way guy that certainly has that offensive punch. But I think to get somebody like that, certainly at the latter end of the off-season, I think is a good pickup. I mean, being 33 years old and pretty much playing in most of the top European leagues, I think, yeah, he's got that experience that is going to be valuable when it comes to our sort of defensemen mentioned, like Tetlow, potentially Hazeldine. I mean, we don't know where Hazeldine will play. I mean, he can play both forward and defence, but learning from these guys will certainly help him. Even if he becomes a bit like a utility player, he's got both elements to his game. But yeah, definitely somebody I think will be a big go-to guy. And like Sam says, he's certainly a mobile player, and that seems to be a bit of a trend in our defence this year, whereas last year we were very slow, lumbering, and your quicker teams like Dundee and your Fife, your Guildford, they really started to hurt us last year. But this year, we've certainly got that mobility and, like Sam said, transitioning up the ice and making that good first pass. I think it's going to be a lot better this year, and DeSantis as well as Connolly are both going to be key guys for that.
Agreed. Jono, obviously, get your thoughts on DeSantis as well, but I just wanted to see what your thoughts are about the whole jersey unveiling, doing it away from the norm. I think I can't remember us doing this sort of thing in the past. By the sound of it, the venue wasn't big enough.
No, and I think that was the fear. And I think that's probably why they had it on a lunchtime when maybe not as many people could attend, but obviously a lot of people did, and it was a building society branch office. It was still going about its normal day-to-day business, so yeah, it was perhaps I can sort of understand it from a sponsorship point of view, but it was perhaps not the best idea overall. But you live and learn, and they probably won't do it again, and they'll probably choose a nice big room in a hotel or something for the next one, or maybe somewhere at the NIC. But yeah, I mean, I suppose you've got to try these things. But I think from the video that was shown from there, I don't think it worked too well, unfortunately.
But like you say, you've got to try these things. And your thoughts on DeSantis?
Yeah, looks a decent pickup, not a lot I can really add to what Sam and Joe have said. I think I agree with Sam that our defence looks a lot better this season. It looks strong. The main thing is what I like is with 15 inputs, we've signed a spare from the get-go, and I like that very, very much.
Well, me too. It'd be nice if we could bring in a spare forward too. But hey, beggars can't be choosers. Finally, then, obviously DeSantis completed our team for the time being. But it would be amiss to not talk about our new, for now, backup goalkeeper. 24 years old, has plenty of Elite League experience. Jono, I'll stay with you because you're pretty happy about this, aren't you? Jackson Whistle, welcome to the Panthers.
Yeah, great pickup. Really, really good pickup. A great bit of business by Gigi Sett and Tim Wallace. And for whatever reason, he left Sheffield from what was said. Aaron Fox, the Sheffield coach, told him that he needs to take a pay cut and fight for his number one spot, but gave him the opportunity to leave. I mean, I think he probably did fit into Aaron Fox's plans due to the fact that Sheffield have now had to go out and buy a couple of important netminders, but he gave him the choice. Jackson Whistle decided to leave, and I think it's to our benefit, without a doubt, because he has come in as backup. I don't think I'd have been as enthusiastic if he'd have come in as a starting netminder, if I'm perfectly honest, but I think this is a great move by the Panthers, because I expect him, he will start at least 20 games this season. If you think about it, 54 game Elite League season, there's going to be at least 8 Challenge Cup games, at least 3 Continental Cup games. That's 65 games before you get into any knockout stages or a potential Continental Cup final. So you could be looking at around 70 games this season. There is no way that you can expect Kevin Carr to start 60 plus games. He's going to need a break, and we've probably got the best backup in the league, quite frankly, in Jackson Whistle. And I think I'm hoping it's a bit of a development move for Whistle, where he'll be back up this season, maybe back up next season, and then we'll look to start him in a couple of seasons. And the thing is, he has got experience. He's been a starter in Belfast. He's been a starter in Sheffield, two huge Elite League clubs. So there's no reason why eventually he can't be a starter here in Nottingham. And the benefits that brings with having a British starter as your number one netminder. So I am hoping it's a long-term move. It's not just a one-season thing. And he will eventually become our starting netminder once he's had a little bit more development.
Joe, it's not often you can get a player who's represented GB at the top level. You know, we can say that now. He stepped out against the world's best at the end of last season. Like Jono said, he's been a starter at Belfast. He's been a starter at Sheffield. And now he's here to fight for the number one spot. You know, there's no negative to this signing, is there?
No, which makes some parts of the fan base moaning about the signing even more baffling. I mean, like Jono said, I think we've got the best backup in the league. I mean, I think a lot of negativity came with him because he's potentially not quite at the level that Sheffield acquired him to be, to certainly challenge for the league and be in the Panthers-Sheffield rivalry. Some Panthers fans sort of maybe had a negative view on him, and they've sort of carried over. But if you sort of look at it sort of retrospectively, he is one of the best backup goalies in the league. Simple. There is no downside to this signing. He gives us the freedom to ice, you know, full imports when he's playing. And I mean, even if we end up bringing in a junior, like a younger Brit backup, and then they both play, that allows us to put another outskater import. So with this signing, we've got way more sort of options for Wallace to explore in terms of lineup. And like Jono said, we roughly expect him to play at least 20 games. I think he could easily start against half of the teams in this league and put us in a good chance of winning games. So yes, at the moment he's a backup, but I don't think he's really that far away from being a starter in this league, one that's good enough to really challenge for the league.
I mean, Sam, does Jackson suffer from the fact that he's not Ben Bounds? Everybody looks at Ben Bounds as, you know, he's probably the best British goalie I've ever seen. Is that a problem?
No, I don't think it's a problem. It's more an opportunity. You know, essentially there's someone there for him to dethrone. And if Jackson Whistle plays well, and, you know, he plays really well for us, and he takes the number one spot from Kevin Carr, from how well, you know, if he's playing really well, then that only gives Pete Russell, you know, a dilemma. You know, if Whistle's playing really well, you know, and he played quite well at the World Championships, you know, there wasn't, when he came in for Ben Bounds, there wasn't anything really, you know, he didn't play badly. You know, both goalies got scored on quite a bit. It's not, it wasn't really the goaltending that was the problem. But, you know, he's got the ability to challenge Bounds for the, you know, the GB number one position. So, you know, it's up to him to try and grab it with both hands.
And it makes it all the sweeter that it's upset our nearest and dearest up the Vienna. Anything that you guys want to finalise before we move on to the next item on the agenda? Going back over just your overall thoughts on this team, because that will bring in a couple of the comments we've had.
I like the look of it. On paper, it certainly doesn't look as good as probably Belfast, Sheffield, Cardiff, if I'm honest, but it's certainly been built with a team ethic in mind, and I think it's been built with a view to closing the gap on Cardiff and Belfast, because they were, what, 22 points ahead of us at the end of last season, and I think if we close that gap by a substantial amount, then I think that would have to be classed as an improvement season. I won't say successful. I'm going into this season domestically with absolutely no expectations, but I am expecting improved team performance and a much harder working team than what we had last season. And to be honest, I'll take that at the minute. And I hope, as I've said earlier, it's the foundations of building something that we can grow over the next few seasons and look to emulate the likes of Cardiff.
Sam?
I think, as Jono said there, it's definitely a roster with potential. It's got to be one that's nurtured and, you know, allowed to grow. I think, yeah, you know, it just has to be given time. You know, it's like Jono says, I'm not really expecting us to be, you know, challenging for the league title come right near the end of the season. But I do think, you know, it has to be a challenge that doesn't fall away in December, I think, because...
Or November is the last two seasons.
Or November, yeah. It will definitely would be a start to make it into the next calendar year and still be challenging for the league title.
Panthers 2020 title challenge. Joe, anything from you?
Yeah, I like the roster that we've sort of has been put together. I think as we mentioned already, I think it's a balanced roster overall. On paper, yes, we maybe look a bit short on goals, but I think other players we have got, they've got the right sort of attitude and sort of work rate that hopefully we'll see sort of an upturn in the production from the whole team sort of together. So I'm not, at the moment, I'm not worried particularly about goals, but that could change a few weeks into the season. But yeah, in terms of, like they said, I don't particularly expect us to sort of be or win the league, but I'm certainly hoping for to really push sort of what people are sort of putting up there as this top three teams to beat in Sheffield, Cardiff and Belfast. If we can sort of really push them and, like they said, still, you know, be there and thereabouts come sort of middle of March, then I'm certainly going to be happy with that. And I think that's something we've not had for quite a few years. And if that turns out, if we do end up getting that, that's very much a good foundation to then push on in future seasons to then really go after that, the league. And maybe a bit then, like what Cardiff done.
Yeah, maybe then build that dynasty that Jono and I certainly talked about after we, that night in Belfast, when we thought it was the start of something long and prosperous. Oh, how wrong we were. First, obviously, nobody knows what this team's going to look like until you see them in action. The first chance you're going to get is this coming Saturday, 7 p.m. face-off against the Cardiff Devils in pre-season friendly action. Tickets are available now. The follow-up game in Cardiff is 6 o'clock on Sunday. We'll move over to then some thoughts from social media. Jono, I'll come to you first, since you've been monitoring the social media feed. There's one sort of thing that I've seen crop up on a couple of the tweets that we've had is the CVs. We've already sort of mentioned it briefly ourselves, but a lot of people, like for instance, we've got a tweet from Anthony Thomas. I think we massively lack goals due to few stellar snipers. Could you please raise the question of why we haven't signed 2 to 3 guys with numbers from AHL, DHL, KHL with our budget? I know it's only elite prospect stats, but a Lingley, Martin, Ling signing or 3 is very affordable with 5,000 plus fans.
Yes, it is. But we don't know what the budget is. We don't know what budget Neil Black has given to Doucette and Wallace. So from that point of view, we just don't know. Why haven't we signed 2 to 3 guys with numbers from AHL, DEL, KHL? Because we've done that before and it's not worked. I think what people need to get into their heads is this is a completely different mindset change for the Panthers. We seem to have steered away from these great individual resumes but never seem to work out as a team on the ice. We appear to have gone for not as good resumes but what will hopefully build into a very, very good team. Now, I do agree with the point about lacking goals. I think we do. And I did some stats for my Periscope last week where I was looking at goals from the top four. And if I can just pull it out here. I was looking at the goals. So last season, the Panthers forwards scored 131 goals for an average of 10.9 goals each. If you compare that with the Steelers, for example, they scored 192, Giants 166, Devils 195. So on those pure stats, we look a long way behind the top three contenders. But you never know how this is going to play out when we play together as a team. But at the same time, I do think we do look a little light on goals, purely going on the stats that we've got.
I mean, Joe Reese was in touch. He's picked up on what Jono said. You know, we've gone for players in their primes, proven at similar sorts of levels to the league, rather than big CV signings who would take this league for granted, and that have done us no favours in recent seasons. He thinks it's an underrated roster. Your thoughts?
Yeah, I'd have to agree. I mean, we've all seen these big players that sort of think, oh yeah, they're going to be sort of real go-to guys. They're going to rack up the points for this team. They're going to sort of lead this team to a really like strong title push. And then a month or two in, usually around Christmas time, it fades away. So I really think that with this work ethic, that can really sort of keep us going throughout the season. And like with the previous comment on why we aren't signing these big players out of, who will put good numbers from AHL, DEO, KHL, we, for the most part, we've been signing players that are either going into their prime, in it, or just a slightly out of it. Now, if players in sort of those age ranges are still putting up good points, are quick and work hard, why are they dropping down to this league? Because those qualities and abilities are still going to be wanted in the KHL, AHL, DEL. So I think people have got to accept, we can't get those players because those players are still able to perform at a really good level. For example, with Martin St-Pierre, is he going to be as quick as the players we've got? No. Is he likely to work as hard? Maybe not. So it's one of those things. We want this hard-working, quick team, but we just ain't going to get it with these really old players that have had a lot of experience from everywhere else. So people have just got to change their mind frames about what kind of stats that our players are going to put up with the way we're going.
Sam, your brother's just nailed his poster to the side of Sheffield's a banner of anti-Steelers fans there. Your thoughts, because I mean we did have a couple of other tweets. Obviously, our mucker Adam Reddish, he's feeling pretty underwhelmed. Although he does acknowledge it's team orientated, but again comes back to the lack of goals. Dezo again underwhelmed. It's a recurring theme, certainly on social media, that we've seen.
Yeah, but I think if you just look at the pure stats, then, you know, there is a potential for you to be underwhelmed. But I think a lot of it is a wait and see, you know. It's all going to come down to how well they play on the ice. You know, a lot of the time, these CVs, you know, they don't give you the full picture because, you know, you can sign a brilliant player on in terms of his CV, but it might not work out. But you could sign a player that doesn't have, like, the best CV and, then, you know, they can be really good in this league. I think, I think we're just going to have to be patient, and it very much is just a wait and see.
And just to wrap up this section, we had a tweet from Adrian, and I'll throw it open to the three of you, and I'll read it word for word. I shouldn't be surprised, but do you find it somewhat cynical and hypocritical of fans who wanted Bulmer banned for what he did to Stevie Lee and others, yet are so happy to see him on the roster? Jono, come to you first.
Nature of the beast, isn't it? I had to have a look back at the incident, actually, because I was actually at that game. And Bulmer and Stevie Lee dropped the gloves, so they do square off for a fight. I think the thing was that Bulmer hit Stevie Lee while he was down on the ice.
But he
didn't get the ban, but he's still a bit of a no-no. But you know what? It was last season, and generally, fans are always going to be fickle. If he comes and signs for your team, then yeah, people are going to forgive him. You only have to look, and I'm going back a few years, but when Scott Allison signed for the Panthers after what he did to Barry Nicar in the infamous bench clearance, but Barry Nicar seemed to welcome Scott Allison into the team. So, you know, I think it's water under the bridge now, and, you know, Bulmer is now a Panthers player, and I will support him as a Panthers player.
As we will the rest of them. Any final thoughts on that you guys want to pick up before we finish off the podcast for tonight? No? Mm-hmm. Okay. No. So, we obviously, we touched on it earlier. Panthers did a jersey reveal on Friday at the Nottingham Building Society branch in City Centre. The three jerseys been revealed, a nice black home number, a white away number, and then an alternate third jersey, which is green this year, Jono. You love it, don't you?
I can't stand it. I think it looks horrible. but that is just my opinion. I just don't like it. Just don't like it. I think the black and the white are okay. They're not vastly different from previous seasons. So my money will be staying in my pocket once again this season. But you know, if you like them and want to buy them, that's absolutely fine. It's just not for me. One thing I will say, though, is once again, I'd like to see Panthers having an identity with a colour. We say black and gold. We've got a black shirt. We've got a white shirt. We used to have a gold shirt. No gold shirt this season. I'd like to see us identify with a colour, like Steelers identify with orange, Giants identify with teal, Cardiff identify with red, etc., etc. I'd like to see us pick a colour and just go for it with that colour, and then we can have an identity.
You see, that I do agree with you, but I'm completely opposite with regards to the green jersey. I must admit, the photos that I've seen of it so far, I'm a massive fan. But then, for me, green is Nottingham's colour, so it's nice to have that representation in the Panthers fan base. And it's certainly not that sort of sickly green that we had at Christmas a few seasons ago. So I'm probably doing the opposite to you and actually spending some of the money I saved on my season ticket on a new jersey.
Forest and County don't play in green, though, do they?
Didn't they used to?
Nope.
The goalies do. There you go. back in the days when all goalie shirts used to be just green. Okay, so we'll go overall. Obviously, this is our first podcast of the new season. I think I can probably guess who your three main contenders are. So we'll leave that till last. But Joe, first, whose roster has impressed you the most from what you've seen that have been signed so far? Obviously, you probably can't count with Fife in that because, as normal, they leave everything till the last minute.
I think overall, and taking into consideration on ice and off ice, I think Belfast for me. With there being such a big turnover from last season, there was very much the question, or would they be able to bring in such a good sort of caliber of squad again? But I think, well, going off stats, they've definitely done that. And for me, they're the team to beat. I think Cardiff, I think there's the potential that Cardiff have sort of gone 1 year too many with keeping their core of players. And for Sheffield, while they've had they've got a good squad on paper, Fox to me is still too unproven compared to that of Keith and Lord in this league.
And here's me thinking you were going to pick out St. Pierre as your signing of the summer. Sam, who stood out for you from the other teams?
I think, you know, Liam Reddix is a very good signing by Belfast. I think, you know, they've signed the captain of an SHL team. I think that's, you know, that's a very impressive signing. And Rab as well from Glasgow. I think that's another impressive signing. And it, you know, I saw when he was linked to this league, I was hoping we were the team that had signed him, but Yeah, I think they those are two very impressive signings.
And finally, Jono, your sort of main thoughts on those that you expect to be at the top of the table?
Yeah, I think it'll be between Cardiff, Belfast, Sheffield. I actually agree with what Joe said regarding Aaron Fox. I actually looked into his sort of back history, and he's only been a head coach for 6 months last season, or probably less than that. Before that, he was a sports manager, which I think is like a GM role. So I was really surprised when I saw that. But I think he's come in to do a much better job at Sheffield, and let's face it, they need it. They had a really horrendous season by their standards last season, and I think he will improve that. It's very rare though that we get someone brand new to this league coming in and winning the league. The last coach that managed that was Ben Simon, also at Sheffield in 2010-11.
So they do have previous,
but I tell you what, if he does come in and he wins the league, that'll deserve a lot of respect, because he'll have done very well. I do think they probably are slightly on the old side, Sheffield, probably a little bit too old, but they have signed some stellar CVs. They actually remind me very much of sort of a Corey Nielsen Panthers roster, to be honest. They look very exciting. I think they're going to be a very exciting side to watch, and they have got an excellent core of Brits as well. I think Blair Riley is an outstanding signing by Cardiff, because Cardiff get pipped to the post by the Belfast Giants last season, and they think to themselves, how are we going to take that title back? So they go to Belfast and they sign their captain, who was one of their best players, not only for the Belfast Giants last season, but also in the Elite League. So I think that's for me, that is probably the best signing in the league overall, is Blair Riley going to Cardiff. I think that's an outstanding pickup for Andrew Lord. But some other great signings as well. So the likes of Chad Rowe has already been mentioned, going to Glasgow. Glasgow, who looked very, very good offensively, looked really stacked on their offensive lines. Not so much defensively, but I think that they're going to have one of the best offences in the Elite League next season, from looking at the players that they've got. And then
they
also
have signed Colleen in goal, who was, you know, highly touted as, you know, somebody that a lot of the fan base would have liked to have seen and come to us.
Yeah, and he's a very, very good netminder, but I'm just not so sure of the overall quality of the defence in front of him. They could prove me completely wrong, but I just think if there is a weakness in that Glasgow Clan side, I think it's maybe defensively, but offensively, I think they look outstanding. And then obviously Sam Pierre, who's already been mentioned, very good pickup by Sheffield, and then Liam Reddox, also already mentioned, but that's a huge sign. Actually, a very good article on British Ice Hockey Today about Liam Reddox's pickup by Belfast, so that's well worth a read.
Definitely. Okay, then, to finish off then, gang, who's your pick for the title next season, Joe?
Belfast.
And any thoughts on who might win the two cups? I mean, the Challenge Cup and the playoffs, not the Aladdin Cup, by the way.
Coventry for the Aladdin Cup, because we never win it.
I'll be optimistic and say us for the Challenge Cup. And then I'll say Belfast again for the playoffs.
Belfast double. Sam?
I think Belfast for the league. Sheffield for the playoffs. And Cardiff for the Challenge Cup.
Ooh,
and we'll win the Continental Cup.
I actually agree with Sam there regarding the Continental Cup. I certainly expect us to reach the final, and then I think
hopefully host.
I think if we do get the final, we will host it, and that will give us a huge advantage in trying to win it for the second time. But I do think we've got a really good opportunity of winning the Continental Cup. But as for the league itself, I said earlier on my Periscope last week, I think the Belfast Giants will retain their title because they. I was looked at their roster, and I thought, there's something lacking. And then they made their final five signings, and they now look stacked.
Stacked.
They look absolutely stacked, and I think they will win the league. I think Cardiff will run them close, and I think Sheffield will be up there. But I think Cardiff, Sheffield, and Belfast, there's a lot of expectations in their fan bases to win the Elite League title. So two of them are going to be disappointed, and it'll be interesting to see of the two, maybe even all three. If they don't win the title, it'll be interesting to see what sort of fallout comes from that after they've signed really outstanding rosters, all three of them, or certainly on paper. As for the cups, I really don't know. I think it's a bit of a lottery. I think put Glasgow in the mix for one of the titles, I think, because of their offensive talent. And I think you've got to put Izzet in the mix as well for maybe a playoff or a challenge cup. So I think perm any one from five for the other two trophies, but I think for the Elite League trophy, I think Belfast have just got that little bit too much quality for everybody else.
I must admit, I agree with you. On paper, their roster looks, like was said, stacked. The thing for me is Sheffield rarely have two bad seasons in a row, and as bad as we were last year, they were worse, even though in the games between us they were actually better than us. But I can see Sheffield pushing there, and I'm intrigued to see what this Cardiff roster can do. It's already been mentioned that is it one season too many, but then how do they take the disappointment of blowing it on the last day of last season? So
I think the continuity at Cardiff is a massive advantage to them, though, because they can hit the ground running, because they know how each other play. I think they've only got three or four new imports, so that's a team that certainly knows each other, and that is a massive advantage for them.
And I'm also intrigued to see how Belfast in particular do in the Champions League. You know, they've signed a really good roster on paper, that, you know, a couple of wins and maybe qualification. I know there was an article from Ryan Finity where he talks about how the league's improved, and, you know, and certainly Cardiff's owner, he's talked about them qualifying from the group as well. So it can only be good for the league. You know, as we go on, and no doubt we'll talk a bit more about that in future podcasts. I think we've covered about everything we need to tonight. We've gone on a little bit, so unless anybody else wants to say anything in particular, say no. Okay, we'll say thank you and good night. So thanks, first of all, Joe Balm.
Good night.
Sam Balm.
Good night.
And of course, Mr. Cat's Whiskers himself, Jono Bullard.
Good night. Enjoy the season.
My name is Antoine Marie-Jeanne. Take care. We'll see you again soon.